guys. Thank you very much for waiting. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm going to be clicking some buttons.
Hello and welcome to another Redacted. Today is Wednesday, the 13th of July.
Is it? Is it not something Friday like the 13th? Because that's what it feels like.
It feels
like
that way, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It does feel that way.
So I threw up I just found an image on Google. Like there's a little frame rate thing right here. This guy's getting 24 frames a second. What a noob. But yeah, so Soros is MIA, so we really hope everything's okay with him. He just wasn't here, so I kind of threw everything together, and I had to use OBS Studio, which is why sound is really weird right now and everything, because I had to use a whole new program to make it easy to Chroma Keyboard Gamer with my program that I normally use, which is just regular OBS. It's really hard. So I literally learned how to use a new program in the last 20 minutes. So,
just to put it a little bit in perspective, me and Twerk only recently said, I hope nothing's bad happened to him. Because before that, we were like, what the fuck?
Yes, where the fuck is he? Now I got to do all this shit. Hopefully the mics sound good. Hopefully Board Gamer sounds good. Let me know. Give me some feedback. If I need to put somebody, like if I need to up Board Gamer sound a little bit, I will. But everything should be okay. So I think we can kind of get started. The other thing is we're going to have video that's up there, but it's going to be weird sometimes. I'm going to be playing with it. So,
Do I have to pretend to be more engaged this time? Because normally I just let you and Soros talk and then just pitch in.
Yeah, but now that I'm going to have to do both my and Soros's job, you're going to have to be really engaged this time. But yeah.
And I know you could do both your and Soros's conversations.
I think, yeah, I'll talk to myself because I am going crazy right now. So I could talk to myself and everything will be okay. But I think thank you for everyone for stopping by. This is obviously the Redacted Podcast with Torque17 and Board Gamer, which is pretty different. We usually, one of us is usually the one that's missing, right? And then Soros does it on his own with those guys. But this week was a pretty wild week, man. ATV went to your homeland, Board. And
I heard something about the ATVs.
You heard something about it?
I heard something about it. I mean, there's some Bengalists. Bangles or bangles or bagels or something.
Yeah, it was no big deal. Nothing. No big deal.
Some whiteboard action. I had that was the most.
Some whiteboard
part.
Action. Yeah. Some serious fucking whiteboard action that everybody went berserk over.
I mean, that's the sort of thing I want from ATV. I don't give it. Actually, I do give a damn about the amazing, beautiful pre-rendered ship stuff. But I also care about whiteboards.
Yeah, and you know you got Aaron Roberts. Just showing the studio. This tour was a little different than the LA tour for me. I think they kind of sped through it a little bit, right? Number one, so it's way bigger.
Just when you think that nothing is more awkward than the combo of Sandy and Ben together, they then put Aaron Roberts on the camera, who's clearly amazing at his job, but doesn't really know how to react.
He said stuff and things more than anyone I've ever heard in my entire life.
I love him so much. I think he's amazing.
Oh my god, I felt so bad. Everybody was picking on his accent too, because he kept saying ships, but it sounded like shits. And everyone kept saying, oh my god, look at all the shits. And I was like, guys, come on. Like, please. Give the guy a fucking break. He doesn't want to do this.
Amazing. Yeah. So, yeah, I think he's got the same thing as Brian Chambers. I feel that Brian Chambers doesn't want to do the interviews because they're too busy working. They're genuinely really into their work.
But at the same time, I think Brian Chambers really likes doing...
He does it ironically.
Yeah. Like, I think he really likes doing it.
Aaron had to be convinced, it feels, to go, do we really have to do this? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Can't we just make a computer game? Why do we have to be interviewed every week? What?
Yeah, like, I think he went up to this guy and was like, yeah, this guy really likes being on camera. And the guy's like, fuck my life. Why?
I love it so much because that's pretty. they're just not used to being on camera. It's like, hi.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Shit. I don't even know what to do right now. But yeah, I mean, that was pretty cool. and everything.
It was actually pretty damn cool.
Yeah.
But it was just awkward.
Yes.
Beautifully awkward.
But dude, that place is huge.
Yeah.
Huge. He was like, oh, we're on this level. Okay, we're on that level. All right, we're on this level.
Well, so there's huge tax exemptions in the UK, possibly in Europe and the Frankfurt offices as well.
Well, definitely like in the UK, right?
Yeah, I think they save like 20% of the costs in the UK.
So that's why they're pumping everybody over there.
Yeah, makes sense. It makes sense.
For sure. And yeah, so, I mean, there were so many levels. There was the ground floor, I think there was 3 or 4 levels, and then just they packed people in. So it's really good to see, like, we've seen the inside of the studio before, but we've never seen
so that have you much not been in like the UK office environment before? Have you not seen them?
Well, they've showed it, but they haven't showed it like they showed it this time. They didn't do a walkthrough like this.
I'd say this is quite a lot of space for an individual work person.
Okay. I mean, like, they usually pack them in pretty solid.
Yeah. That's my experience of working in an office.
Oh, that was just the first floor. Now they're on to another one. But, dude, it's pretty crazy. They show on this second floor, I guess this is now considered the first floor, where it looks like there's like a children's playroom in the back, right?
That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. But it turns out, like, I asked them what it was on my stream because there's a few of them.
It's for them.
It was it was an old app. Like the this floor used to be an app developer.
Okay.
So it was like a creepy app developer. It looks like little kids, like cooking app.
I'm gonna say like they have got like a bouncy castle and a ball pit, and it's for them. Their chill out room.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like this area used to be where like they had their kids come and play or something, but no. They definitely did not. It used to be an app store, or like some app developer that was up here, and they kind of said, "Get the fuck out! We're making a cooler game than that." And
don't these really, really, really make you stare at the backgrounds now? Now that you know there's little tiny Easter egg leaks,
yeah,
you're staring at every screen and then trying to take pictures and screenshots of it. What's that guy working on there?
Yeah,
you can see there's some bars and gauges. What's that?
Have you been to the UK studio before?
No, there's an issue with me doing that. I don't like not being able to talk about stuff.
So during CitizenCon last year, you didn't go?
No. I was the only reason I'm okay with the Eva Carty stuff now is because I don't know. I don't really know. I just felt it was okay at the time. I might change my mind again by now, but I don't like not being able to speculate. I don't like not being able to talk about stuff.
Because I think this next one is going to be, because I think they said they're going to save Germany for last or something, where I think the next one might be Austin. And I've seen the inside of the Austin studio, so I think I know where to look for the...
So is Austin the smallest?
Well, okay, I don't know what the other studios... I've never been in the other studios, but Austin's small. It's one floor.
We've seen LA.
Yeah.
In last week's ATV, and we've seen the UK now, and Germany. We keep on seeing little walkarounds, and it's huge.
Yeah.
So
Austin's small. Okay. It's definitely a smaller studio, but they also like have this awesome balcony and stuff like that, which is really cool. So. It's got its perks, and they had a keg, which was cool. So I think that's all I can really say about it. But, yeah.
NDA broken. They've got a keg.
They got a keg, and we drank some beer while we were there, which was pretty great. And celebrated some birthdays. There's Luke on the screen. There's Luke Presley, and then Danny Reynolds is right next to him. Those are the two guys that literally make the PU for everybody. It's really cool. But, yeah, I think moving on from that, there's some cool things that we saw in the UK studio, which I'm gonna take this off, and I'll show one of the things on screen. Is we saw new explosions. Did you see that board? Some of the new explosions.
I'm not sure if I did.
So they walked by this guy's computer, and he showed the Reliant exploding. Do you remember that? Did you completely miss that?
Well, I was too busy looking at a single screenshot to care.
Yeah, oh, the so here
is there...
I don't know if you could see the stream or not, but there it's up on the screen now, and it's actually it's a Giphy, so it's just gonna scroll back and forth every 15 seconds. So it'll you see the kind of new explosion animations. They don't look that much different, but I guess the big thing is it's a Reliant that they're showing with it. It's pretty tiny. Oh,
so yeah, so in my head when I can't really see what's going on there.
Yeah.
Because too low res at that point.
Yeah, but he zooms in a bit and you see a little bit of it. It looks all right. I mean, it doesn't look much different than from what we have now, but maybe this is like the MISC explosion, right? Because we definitely have like the M50 300i exploding in red, and you have the like other ships exploding in blue and things like that. So maybe this is a MISC explosion. I don't know, but I thought that was pretty cool. What else?
I do like that each of the ships are going to have their own explosion styles, but is that going to be the ship has its own explosion styles or the components on the ship or both?
I think they're going to eventually do it with the components, but I also heard that they want to do it by manufacturer.
Yeah.
Possibly, okay. Which I think is a little weird. I think it's better to do it by component, right?
Yeah, I mean, you want manufacturing the fact that you want to see the shrapnel coming off manufacturer. Yeah. But the explosion type, it has to be based on the component, surely, because different types of reactor, different types of whatever. Well, yeah. I'm sure whatever they do will be amazing looking. I don't doubt that.
That we can't doubt. Whether it'll be at above 19 frames a second is a whole other story right now.
Single player will be fine. At the moment, I do feel that the multiplayer gets a little bit overly slammed because people are like, how do you get such smooth frames? And I like, well, a lot of the time I'm recording
single player right?
Or whatever. Well, not all the time. I mean, I get good frames in the multiplayer servers because I know how to pick them. You go, this server's dying, you change server. But yeah. Those multiplayer servers, I mean, I'm pretty sure that part of that development process is them literally trying to be as efficient as possible with them. I think they could have.
It's also
servers.
Still in its infancy, right?
Well, yeah, but I honestly think it's server hardware and CPU cores. I think they're trying to get like 30 frames a second consistently with as few cores as possible, because for them it will save them so much money if they can get that efficient now.
Yeah.
So I think maybe that's what they're doing. I mean, that's pure speculation by me. More speculation than normal.
And we know that they're working on things, and it should improve in the next few months. We should see, hopefully, staggering improvements up. Over the next few months, and that'll be really nice. I don't know how this is going to look here. I'm a little nervous about this one. This is the only one I didn't really test to see how it'll look. So let's see how this one goes. But this is the... it's going to be really small probably on screen, but this is the ship.
Venus. Oh, okay. That makes more sense.
Ship thing. So yeah, at first it's probably going to look really, really bad, but I'm going to shrink it down to make it look not
us
so
in
bad.
The UK, we pronounce it shits.
Yeah.
Actually.
So yeah, it looks... not very good at all, so I'll do my best here. No, doesn't want to be nice. But yeah, it's super tiny, so I don't know how well you guys are going to be able to see this, but hey, that's it right there. We'll just put it, it's the size of my head. Let's see if we can make it a little bit bigger, right?
We can walk people through it.
There you go. So that's it nice and big now. So, I'm missing the top a little bit as well. Cringe face. All right, so there we go.
That's just a little bit of it. That's all. It's all good. It's all good. It'll be fine.
Okay, so there we go. I think we got it all in there. So, this was on the ship guys, I guess, the ship producer from the UK. This was on his whiteboard. So, it said LA... they had the Anvil
hurricane
ready to go. They're going to start. It seems like they're going to start working on that. And then in the UK, they were working on three ships, which is not surprising because they mentioned that they had 21 ship artists or something like that there. So there's
the context just above where it says LA that we can't see. It says design brief.
Yeah, that's right. It says design brief, which is probably just he took notes on a meeting or something, perhaps, right? Would that, does that make sense to you for that?
Yeah, maybe.
What do you think it means?
I'm interested. I don't really know. I don't know the context of all of it. I mean, it's all very exciting for us to consider what it all means. And we will speculate heavily.
yes. But this is like super speculate time.
I don't really know. I mean, I don't know why he'd need to, why someone else would need to know what studios have what allocated, unless he's designing components separately for those ships.
Well, no, I think he's the producer that
all of it. See,
that is that his job is to oversee ships.
Oh, if he's overseeing all of it, then yeah, that, okay.
So it would make sense that he would need to know what guys are doing what ships. On. Yeah.
Yeah. That they then I think this is the literally the allocation of what's currently being worked on.
Yeah, where, or what's going to be worked on in the near future, maybe.
It stands to reason to me that this is probably allocated resources.
Okay.
Because there's lots of other stuff I know they're doing, or probably doing, that isn't on that list.
Yeah, like the Argo's not on that list, which I found kind of interesting.
But that's because the Argo
is already done.
It's already been locked into somewhere. So okay. The Terrapin, probably the Terrapin saying ready for sale there, is ready for sale and they haven't decided when it's coming yet. That's what it suggests to me. But what do you think? Should we go through the whole list?
Well, I think the big one, okay, so you got the Anvil Hurricane, and you can't really read what it says.
Something Chris Roberts, I think.
Yeah, like Ask Chris or something, I don't know.
It'd be Ask Chris Roberts.
Yeah, I think that might be Ask. But then you go to the UK and it's the Origin 600, which is like, that's double the 300. So
the only reference we have of the 600 is in a lore piece.
Okay. Tell me, because I didn't see that.
So literally in the Origin Jumps Works kind of lore piece, it says that the Elite 600 series was originally built on Terra or Earth. I can't actually remember the wording. And it isn't anymore, basically, for some reason.
But it's an Elite ship.
It's their Elite series.
So why isn't it the Origin 1337?
I hate you so much. You're so happy with yourself as well. You sounded so smug.
I did it. But no, I wonder if it carries more than one player, right? Because you got the 300, which is like, you know, single seater, kind of. How do you describe the 300? It's such a weird ship. It's not a dogfighter. It's not a cargo ship.
It's a luxury ship.
Yeah, it's just like a ship that you kind of like. Touring. You stop at the stoplight and you're like, yep.
Possibly as a touring ship, but yeah, it's certainly a luxury version of whatever else is similar to it.
Yeah, and I wonder where the 600 goes. Does it go more luxury? Does it have more players? Does it have more cargo space?
So I think it would either be like a supercar. So yeah. Literally go like it's going to be absolutely amazing.
So
stupid.
Another racer maybe? Like,
or another touring ship like the 890 Jump, but smaller, obviously.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure whether it's going to be slightly bigger than a fighter sized, or maybe it's their answer to the Constellation.
Okay. I think it would be cool to see a Freelancer or Constellation size Origin ship.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
I don't think we have much in the way of size from Origin, do we? Right now? Who makes the 890 Jump? Does Origin make it?
Yeah, Origin Jump Works makes the 890 Jump.
Okay. So maybe we see, since okay, so Origin seems to be very much on the luxury side of things. So maybe it's maybe a miniature space yacht, which is what we see in the chat, which I don't know.
See,
I think it's pretty cool.
For me, I think something similar to the Phoenix, but looks pretty.
Because the Phoenix doesn't look that pretty right now.
Well, it looks pretty to some people, but not to me.
I don't like
the way it looks.
But I think the next one is probably the second most, or like, I don't know, the Banu Merchantman is the next one, and that's kind of like holy
shit.
It's about
the Banu though.
Nobody cares about the Banu.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Nobody's
yeah,
been yeah. asking about the Banu Merchantman.
No one has.
I haven't heard anybody ask for that.
Allocation from the UK that's it. Don't you find that's interesting that the UK are doing it?
No.
Do you think that might be it's in Squadron 42?
Perhaps. That's why I'm not that surprised, because maybe there's some interaction. Okay. I think it's a little late for Squadron to... If they were going to do this as a Squadron 42 asset, I think it would have already been done. Right? Like, if you were going to interact with the Banu and you were going to see the Banu Enrichment at some point in the game, I think this ship would have already been done. I think it would have been done before the Caterpillar. I think it would have been done before a lot of ships.
What if they've got the Banu as a quick sub race in Squadron 42? They've got in Episode 1, but they've got loads of plans for the Banu Merchantman and everything in Episode 2.
I think they're starting to make ships that the community is asking them to make.
Okay.
I really think that's where it's starting to go, to some extent, where the community is begging, has been begging for the Banu Merchantman, and they just didn't have the resources to allocate to it yet. And if you look at all these other ships on the list, none of them we've ever heard of. I mean, like, the Hurricane and the Terrapin, yes, we've heard of. They were part of that voting for a starter ship, right? But if you look at the Aegis Eclipse,
it was in with starting ships. I'm not sure if the Hurricane or the...
Are actually starter ships, yeah. Yes. That's a good point. But it really does sound to me like they're at the point where they can start making ships. And then IDD KFA in the chat says, we're also begging for the Carrick, but they've been mentioning that as soon as the Caterpillar is done in LA, the LA guys are going to be working on the Carrick. So that's allocated. That time is spent.
I expect also that will coincide with them bringing on exploration in the actual mini PU.
Yeah,
and ready.
And I mean, if you see ships, like, we're gonna see the Bengal later, right? And
so
given how far along that is, like, yeah, you have to think that a lot of the ships that they wanted for Squadron 42 are likely probably done. And I think that they're ready to just work on the Banu race. So. I think that's kind of where we're at now. It's, again, this is a lot of speculation, and I think there can be all sorts of theories as to why they're working on the Banu, but that's mine. I don't know. So, yeah. And then the Aegis Eclipse, which I know nothing about. Did you see anything? And you clearly looked up some lore and found the Origin 600.
Yeah,
did you find anything on the Aegis Eclipse?
No, I couldn't find anything about the Eclipse, but... one of the devs said Eclipse has multiple meanings rather than having a similar name. So someone said, isn't calling it the Eclipse similar naming system to that of RSI or something?
Lot of the times ships, like, they change manufacturers too. Like, they decide on a design style of a ship and then, like, something happens where it changes manufacturers or something. I think that's happened before, where they just change stuff up.
I'm thinking that the Eclipse could be an interdiction or an EMP ship or an electronic warfare ship or something, maybe.
I just think, like, blocking out blocking something, right?
Yes, that's what I think as well. I think some sort of interdiction, form of EMP warfare, something that stops you from doing something else. I mean, someone said that maybe it means that it's absolutely fucking huge.
That's what I was thinking. Like, it's big enough to block out the sun. If it's in the UK, makes sense. I wonder how much bigger the Banu is gonna get. All right.
Actually, that's a good point. They could all be huge ships, couldn't they?
Like, how much more is the Banu Merchantman gonna cost when the UK gets done with it? Those guys making ships more expensive, one ship at a time.
I have an issue with the Banu Merchantman is that at the moment it's huge. It's as big as an undertaking as them doing at least like an Idris. And
how big is it? It's around 100 meters, right? Or is it more?
More. It's stunning huge because it's wide and tall.
Yeah.
Let's bring up the actual current specs, which have obviously changed.
Quote
massively.
Unquote current, yeah. But whatever they have.
Let's remember, Caterpillar was around 65 meters originally, and now is at least 100 meters, which is.
Yeah, the Idris was 100, now it's what, 150, something like that?
I think the Idris is 200
meters. 200 and what?
230, 260.
Jesus Christ. Okay.
It's between that. It's huge. Yeah. I mean, it's a frigate now. That's why.
I would think it would fall in the 100 meter range. I think it would be the size. I think it would be the Banu's version of the Caterpillar.
Where's the Banu merchantman gone on the ship? Where is it? Here, Banu. Oh, no. It looks like CIG have removed it.
They just said, yeah, we're not doing it. Change our mind. But while you're looking for that, the Ready to Concept was the Origin 85X. And if you guys don't know what that is, that's like the little ship that comes with, and probably not so little, but the ship that comes with the 890 jump. So you have the big 890 jump, and then you have the shuttle that brings people from probably from planet to the 890.
You can actually see a lot of the specs for it in the brochure for the 890 jump.
Oh, yeah. You know, I have a physical version of the brochure somewhere for the 890 jump.
Oh, wow.
I think I'm going to go grab it. It's pretty cool. So we could talk about it. It's right in the other room right here. It's signed by some devs, too.
I'll talk about the Banu while you're gone. So the Banu was planned originally to be 100 meters in length, which is reasonably big. The beam, though, it's the widest ship, 135 meters wide and 70 meters tall. So the interior of it's huge. And CIG like to make their ships fatter as they add more and more things to them. and more ideas get chucked in the spiral. So that ship could be.
This is my favorite part. Coming in 2945. No. But it's pretty cool. So I think this is actually maybe a smaller version of it, but it's pretty cool. It gives you a little thing about the Gauss system, which is cool. And then it just talks a little bit about the 890. So it's a small, it's not the brochure that's on the website, but it's the physical version of it, which is tiny, but it's cool.
One day.
I don't know who it's signed by, but Harbinger got me this, I think, when
My hope is one day that for services rendered to CIG, because I make lots of nice Star Citizen videos, and I talk about the game a lot, they'll give me an 890 jump one day. That's my dream.
It's probably not going to happen, man.
I love, because I could never justify buying an 890 jump.
No, me neither.
Because it's a proper luxury ship, and it's really expensive.
And the luxury ships they don't make sense to me.
No, they don't, because they're just not as functional as other ships that are a lot cheaper.
Yeah.
And they're just, it's the sort of thing that you look at and you go, oh, I want, and you're jealous of other people who get them. But if you had the amount of money they did to purchase that, you still wouldn't purchase that. You'd have bought like two Caterpillars or something.
Yeah.
Such a silly ship.
It is. It's a silly ship right now. And until we see the mechanics with, I guess we have seen some of the transport of human player mechanics, which makes the 890 jump a lot more interesting than when it first was released. But it's still, that's one of the ones I just don't quite get. But yeah, so you have the 85X, which is going to be the little shuttle. It's going to bring people back and forth. And then the Misk Racer I found kind of interesting.
Some people said that said Misk Rover. I think it says Racer as well.
I think it says Racer. And I think we're gonna go a little bit into racing a little bit later. I don't think a lot of people know this. I talked about this on my stream. I didn't announce it anywhere, but it is definitely seeming like it's a thing. Let's continue on with the ships for a little bit, and then we'll go into that next. The next little line is in concept is the Lightning, which is kind of like okay. I guess this kind of contradicts what I was talking about before. Do you think this is the F8 Lightning? There can't be two Lightnings.
It's the F8. It's the F8 Lightning, and I think that they haven't. That I think it will be re-white boxed and totally redone to the current standard, because they you're going to need it in Squadron 42. I don't think it will go on sale.
Whoops.
What?
Not what I want.
What have you done?
I'm trying to get. I'm just being an idiot.
You don't.
Not what I wanted to
do. Breaking the internet.
Yeah, I know. I'm just moving around. Don't mind me.
It's okay. I was trying to fix
one thing, but that's not what I wanted. Yeah, but I don't know. It's got to be the Lightning. And then do you think they're going to sell it?
No, I did not.
I don't think so either. I think this is literally they're working on it.
I would buy it if they did.
I would buy it if they did. I think a lot of people would buy it if they did.
Yeah, I'd probably sell my saber for it. Because I either want a heavy fighter or a medium fighter that has skill involved to it. But if I can just go screw skill,
that's what I
mean. Heavy fighter.
Yeah.
I would. But I'll get one in the verse eventually, I'm sure.
This, I mean, that kind of goes and contradicts what I was saying earlier about the Banu, where they might be kind of complete with their ships as far as Squadron 42, and they have all these artists out there, and they don't have as much work for them to do, right? So that's why they're going to be working on the 600 and the Banu Merchantmen and this Aegis Eclipse. But then you see that the Lightning's still in concept, which means it's like not in the game yet. And that is, that's like an essential, what we know is that that's one of those essential ships that they wanted in the game, what they told us a while back.
That could mean a lot of different things. That could mean the interior is being concepted and they've done the exterior already. That could be a load of different things. That could just be for textures. That could be, that could be a lot of different things. It might not be, it might be that it hasn't been done yet, but I'm pretty sure we saw a leak of it a while ago. Mm-hmm. So unless they're entirely remaking it. I suspect that's probably just the interior, or maybe the components, or something like that.
And where we saw it was on Ship Shape with Lisa, right?
Lisa? So,
Was when Ship Shape first started, they showed us the Anvil, the guidelines that they go to make Anvil ships, and the F8 Lightning was on. And they showed us the exterior. We never saw the interior. So you might be right about the concept of the interior. Definitely thing.
But it could be a lot of stuff. It could be just the way... It could be referring to a very small part of concept.
Yeah.
And it will still be classified as in concept.
Yeah. And then you got the ready for sale Terrapin.
So...
go ahead.
We thought that this could possibly be, well, I did, the Gamescom ship. But now... I'm not so sure.
Well, why wouldn't it? Why? I mean, listen, they're selling the Argo, right? They haven't told us when they're going to sell the Argo. So it's
Argo's not on that list, though, is it?
Argo's not on that list, but that's probably because it's already...
They have told us when the Argo's going on sale.
Did they?
It's going on sale with 2.5.
Oh, confirmed that's right.
We don't have it... Nikki Show, and then again on RTV.
Yeah, but we don't have a date.
No, we don't have a date.
So, and I guess we can talk a bit, since we're talking about ships, we can talk a bit about the Argo, too, because I didn't write any of this in the doc. I was not as prepared as I normally am.
I don't have the doc on screen. I've got Twitch on one screen.
I can't have the doc on screen. Yeah, it's a different setup than what I'm used to, so things are all over the place right now.
And then on the other screen, I'm obviously playing a game on my phone.
What game?
Well, Twerk, it's nice that you asked that, because... I'm actually a Pokemon Master.
I want
master.
To be the very best.
Thanks. I had that ready there for ages.
I know, you're just waiting for me to talk about it, didn't you, you son of a bitch.
I literally got...
So what level are you?
Pokemon, I'm level 17 now. I've been playing since... I've only played since 6 a.m. this morning. But I've read everything. So I'm literally one of the grinding masters of the world. I'm not talking about Daddy Dancing, although I'm pretty good at that as well. I'm just so good at I must level, doing little routes, just running around. I can maintain my weight as well, which was beautiful.
Yeah, like how do your legs feel right now?
Pretty good, actually. There was 3 points next to each other. I was just running around in circles. And every time that someone, because I live by a hospital, a shopping center, a graveyard, and several churches and war memorials, there's just enough people doing other stuff for me nearby. I can just kind of sit down and chill out. Let's take that hat off now. You never should wear a hat indoors. Remember that, Will Leverett.
But I'm level 5. Feels bad, man. I don't know.
You're not MLG pro like me. So.
No, I'm not an MLG pro, but I also live in Florida. Mm-hmm. Harry, the outside. It's also 1 million degrees and 1,000% humidity.
You go outside, you turn into a pillar of salt.
I did. I did use some what is it, like essence or something like that this afternoon, and it was like, oh, there's a 20 minute timer, and I was gonna go to get more Pokemon to come to you. And I was gonna go back in the house like 20 minutes earlier, and I was like, gotta use this, gotta use it, gotta catch them all. And played a little bit, so it was fun, but I haven't gotten to a gym or anything yet.
So I want to talk about Pokemon for just like two more minutes before we
move
on.
Yeah, and then we'll move on. I mean, it's pretty much the craze of the world. I don't know how you can't go without.
Yeah, I mean, literally, so Nintendo shares went up by over 20%. It's making over $1.6 million in microtransactions a day, which is more than spaceships do.
Yeah.
And it's just insane. And the game is awesome socially. I mean, people have talked about these things like people running in roads and killing themselves for Pokemon, and like people parking vans and then doing lures and getting children into their vans. I don't think that happens. It's just other people are saying. But I think the health benefits are great. Like,
yeah, I mean, I walked an extra 20 minutes today that I wouldn't normally walk.
But it's great for, so from a mental health point of view, I think it's getting people to socialize. It's getting people out of the house. It's getting people to team up. I'm sure there will be some mad people that like attack someone else because they're in a different gym than them or something.
Team Blue for life.
Oh, God.
I don't know. Yeah. I went with Team Blue. Bug it.
Instincts. I'm yellow because...
You're yellow? Is Pikachu, man?
Well, I didn't actually go for a Pikachu at the beginning, but my friends are yellow, and they went, go yellow, and I went, okay.
Yeah, that's Proxus is blue, and that's why I went blue.
Oh, I trust Proxus to be blue.
Yep.
Oh, man. But yeah, so I'm quite enjoying it. I'm going to play it quite casually. You won't see it on my channel. You might see one video, or I might, if people really want to see it, I do it on another channel, because a couple of my friends are really into it, and they are going to be doing YouTube channels. But it is fun. Yeah. It's a good laugh.
I've enjoyed it so far. Again, one more minute. My understanding of how the battles are nothing like real Pokemon, right? It's real time.
Yeah. So you the only real battles there are. So you catch Pokemon by just chucking Pokeballs at them.
Yeah.
And you have to actively look around your surroundings in real life to find Pokemon. You can track them and stuff, and certain Pokemon are in certain areas and certain biomes.
Yeah, like I live on a lake and I'm catching all these water Pokemon.
Magikarp.
So many Magikarp.
Garp.
Fuckers.
But you need like 100 of them to get a Gyarados. Oh god, don't even get me started. I'm really enjoying it. And yeah, so the gym battles are the only way to have a battle at the moment. And
they're not real Pokemon battles. Like how you would be used to them.
Just rapidly click and then you can do some abilities. It's really simple.
That makes me sad.
Well, I think it will evolve, as Pokemon do, to a kind of a different level. At the moment, it's like 0.25 as build. So I think there's going to be a lot more coming.
Okay.
It's done by the same guys that did Ingress, and I'm not sure if many people played Ingress, but it was another augmented reality game where you went around to landmarks and you found like cool information when you went there, and you got like clues and things.
That's Ingress. Cool.
And I think they're just using the same backend.
Yeah.
Which is like Google Maps-esque.
Yeah.
I think it's great. I really like it. I suggest that even if you're like, kids game, just check it out. Just check it out.
Yo,
it's free on your phone.
No matter what, like, I don't know. I'm fucking 31 years old. I played Pokemon. That game was awesome.
Our generation, though, isn't it?
Yeah, for sure.
It gives us nostalgia. We wanted to be possibly Pokemon Masters when we were young.
Well, I think for me, I felt like I was a little old when Pokemon came out, but I still played it because I didn't care and I like playing video games. But a lot of my friends were too cool. No? And I was like, fuck you. Like, it's fun. I never played the card game, but the actual Game Boy game.
Anyway,
Grimhex.
Let's go back to Star Citizen.
They showed us Grimhex, dude.
Did show us.
They showed us Grimhex.
Oh, so before we go into that,
yeah.
What do you think the Terrapin might be?
Well,
we've got the original concept blurb.
Yeah, what was the original I mixed the Terrapin and the Hurricane up, so I feel like you're more on point with that. The Terrapin is the one with all the guns, right? Or is that the Hurricane?
The Hurricane is with loads of small bore weapons.
Yes,
think that's what
and the Terrapin is the super shielded, super armored.
Tough not to crack, I think it's referred to as.
Okay.
Yes.
And it aids in mining? Like, merchants use it? That's the one part that I'm a little, like, weirded out by.
So,
They also said that there's a component mount for mercantile type. Potentially, you can put a mining laser on it, I think. I'm going to have to relook at that concept.
I like that idea. I like the idea that there's going to be a chassis that will allow you to do industry stuff at a slightly diminished rate, but is super tough.
Super slow, right?
Yeah, I mean, I like that, though. I like to go, well, I don't mind that I'm going to go out in my super slow but tough ship, because if I do run into pirates, at least I'll just go, for fuck's sake, I can't be asked.
So here, I'll read everybody the Terrapin thing. Literally a tough nut to crack, the Terrapin is the most heavily armored of the base-priced StarCraft on the market, so it is kind of a starter ship. Originally designed...
second-tier starter.
Yeah, so something more like the Reliant. $65 to $75, right? Originally designed for long-range survey missions, so it probably has like a nice radar suite on it. In dangerous star systems, the Terrapin's design philosophy involves wrapping the ship in additional layers of armor and reserving a significant amount of engine power to host the largest shield generator in its class. So, I guess when the shields are going, the engine. This is the original concept. Things obviously can change and probably have changed because it's Star Citizen. They come up with new ideas that'll work for this and they go with it, right? Terrapins are popular among miners with an equipment mount and a small storage hold that can be converted for valuable minerals. So an equipment mount sounds like one of those gun mounts or utility mounts that actually has a piping system. Because remember in the Prospector Q&A, somebody asked, can you put like these mounts on other ships? And they said no, because the piping system won't allow it. And it sounds like this ship, from its original concept, will have that piping system embedded in it, where it can do something like that, potentially fill, you know, a barrel of minerals, or maybe break down salvage and fill a barrel with it. And I think that's
like
kind of interesting.
That more and more ships are becoming super modular. I know that was sort of the idea before, but it's because more and more ships are done in the pipeline and we can see what the kind of modular system's like. I love the idea of doing the different loadouts. I love the idea of it not necessarily being hull-based, but being modular-based.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's just my brain fart that I had.
Yeah, and when was the date of that?
2014?
November 12th, 2014. So a lot has probably changed, a lot will change. May have changed. It's a ship that's just has gone through concept, has had discussions with Ben and Chris and designers and all sorts of things. So things may have and most likely have definitely changed since then. So while it seems like that stuff could be possible, it may not be possible now. It may have changed.
So out of curiosity,
yes,
the Redeemer.
Redeemer, okay.
When do you think we're going to see that flyable track?
I don't know.
Because surely it can't be that difficult to get it flyable. I mean, we can see it in the hangar. It's been there for sodding ages. Well, do you think they're just waiting for more FPS stuff before they get it online?
I don't think that is. I think it actually is more difficult than we think. And I'll go back to when we saw the white box of the Dragonfly. Is we're like, oh shit, we're gonna get it next week, basically. We're all excited. And Matt Sherman popped in the chat and went, slow, calm your tits, Twerk. Calm your tits. Because there's so much more to it than that. Getting all those things to put in and the animations. And yeah, it looks like it's flyable, but
your tits were so uncalm as well. They were just all over the place.
They were not calm. And Matt said, he Dikembe Mutombo'd me. Stop that. So I think it's a lot more in depth than that. And what I do find funny is that people have asked about the Redeemer a lot, and they said they're going to wait for the guy who actually made the Redeemer to work on
it. Getting
right?
Reworked. Yeah, it's getting reworked as well. It's been reminded that it's getting reworked.
So it's one of those ships that they keep saying that they don't have people to work on for it, but then they keep making new ships. And I think we know why that's happening is they got to have ships to sell. Right? And
gonna have ships.
Gotta have ships to sell. And I think that does bother some people. It doesn't bother me personally. I don't know about you, but I want this game to succeed. And I know that they've gotten more and more ambitious as the project went on, and take some cash to make it happen. So I don't mind them selling them and then coming back to the Redeemer later. It just, I don't see a role for the Redeemer in the game yet either.
Okay, well, just, yeah, it just, I keep on seeing it there and thinking, I want to bird fly this around. When we go out and do like group warfare, yeah? When we
like go, the right, Redeemer to, seems like the ship you bring.
Yeah, when we go to Kovalex or when we go to Thingamajig together as a big group,
yeah.
Prayer together, I want to go in a Redeemer now because it just seems sensible.
Yeah, it just makes sense. But
yeah.
I think we might, okay, here's where I think we might see the Redeemer start coming into the devs' minds as something that they probably should work on, is once we get planet. Once we have a planet to land on, don't you think it makes sense? Or more space stations work on?
Yeah, so for me, for some reason, my head doesn't see it landing on a planet. I know it will.
Yeah.
It sees it landing on space stations or boarding ships.
I always saw that ship as a planet side battle.
I suppose we should talk about at some point, not today, we should talk about our expectations of certain ships, because my expectations are going to be totally different to yours.
And that's the greatest thing about Star Citizen, right? Is my expectations of what a ship can do, like, it's the greatest and the worst. And I think it's one of the downfalls of having open development and showing us these things this early, is we get things in our mind about, like, for example, the Retaliator. You know, they put the Retaliator in game. Oh my god, I'm going to launch my giant torpedoes at these ships, and they're just going to melt, and it's going to be amazing. And
one torpedo, and it's going to take down a javelin. Done.
Yeah, and that ship is just...
The Death Star just explodes, mate.
I think out of all the ships that are in the game right now, I think that one needs the most love from a rework or something like that, because we're just... Yeah. Time. So, like... I think that's the greatest thing, is that we all have different expectations, right? Like, I know what I want to do with my miner, or my Orion, and my Prospector, and I bet you have a totally different but similar expectation of what the ship.
Well, so I mean, I suppose this is part of some of the ships that they don't know exactly how mechanics are going to work yet. They want to hear everyone's expectations and then kind of come in to a workable medium.
Yeah.
Of them, maybe. Yeah, we'll either talk about that on the podcast, or we'll do a video of that later.
Yeah, I think that'll be cool. I would love to do like a little collab YouTube video with you about expectations. Be cool.
Oh, someone wants to vampire my views.
No, just on your channel. It doesn't matter.
Whatever, Twerk.
I think
whatever.
It'd be fun. I want to talk about ships with you, man. Leave me alone. I'm not trying to vampire. But no.
I just want to talk about ships.
Yeah, so let's move on, because we have so much shit to talk about. Holy shit. Like, this week was insane. Grimhex, man. What'd you think?
So, I actually did, because I was being lazy, I rewatched the Grimhex little
trailer.
I gotta
mess with this a lot.
And then the close-in stuff that they were, like, showing us how it worked.
I think it's better.
So, I was watching pretty much every frame. I was suitably impressed at the size of it, because from the entry... Then down and down and down and down and down and down and down into an EVA area. It's huge. That station's huge, and it looks beautiful.
Oh yeah. It really is really nice, and I'll show it off here, right now.
Finally got it on the screen. To call home.
Yeah, Saurus has a place to call home, which is awesome. I think we might see them pop, like their face pop up here every now and then. I didn't clip it together or anything, but. I really, really like the look of this station. And I like this specifically, that there's some places that are unfinished or not unfinished, but broken, or there's no gravity,
yeah.
Right? So there's going to be, EVA places. And this in particular is one of the things that I never noticed before, and I'm going to kind of pause it on this part, is there seems to be a little map of Grimhex. Coming up here.
Oh yeah, yeah. Then
in the hallway, you see it, and I never noticed it until I was watching the video today. But yeah, you can kind of. I don't know how we can deduce what any of that is, but I mean, it kind of looks like there's some landing pads and.
So, you know, when we come up from the floor, the broken floor comes up and looks like a control terminal, like a control tower almost, the
Yeah.
grass, just before that map room. That looks like the industrial hangar.
Yeah, I'm sure they took some borrowed some assets from that, right? It would
Oh,
just make sense
yeah.
if you're putting a they're putting it inside of an asteroid. It just makes sense that they worked that art out to make it the way they wanted it already.
And
So it was pretty short.
We think it was called Green Imperial Hex.
So yeah, it's called Green Imperial Hex. And then if you let's see if I can find some of the spots here where there's a place where it's actually graffitied out to make it say Grimhex.
Yeah.
There you go. Oh, so like your like they this one's weird too. This is your home away from home, your home from home or something like that, and that's graffitied. Where's the part where they actually graffitied Grimhex? I think that might have been in some images that we saw at another point.
Oh, I need to analyze that a bit better. There is more than I thought there.
Here it is. So on the map, it's really hard to see. I'm all over the place right now. But they graffitied out everything. There's another spot right here. So right up here, it's GR and then IM, and they take out the aerial part. So on some of the displays and static, and I think what they really want, like, don't you think it kind of was, let's call this place Grim or something. Like, Grim's a good word for pirate, right? So they just said Green Imperial and just made it up. So they, and then graffitied it out. I think the writers are like really, really good at this stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that's an interesting way of implementing it.
I think they've got a load of creative freedom.
Yes.
When it comes to this sort of thing.
Yeah.
And so they can come up with some pretty cool stuff. And because they have the time to study what else is going on in the game, they can then make sure the lore kind of makes sense.
Yep. I wonder what it's like to be a writer on Star Citizen versus other game.
I wonder if they know it like as much as some of the like managing devs, because obviously a lot of the team members won't know exactly what other departments are up to.
Yeah.
I suppose the lore people might kind of know a huge amount.
I think they have to, and that's why Cherry is there, right? Like, Cherry is the one that archives everything, and she's right next to them. She's in the writer's room, so the writers can just go, yo, Cherry, what's going on with this? And they could probably give her the heads up. You know?
She's got an awesome job title, the archivist.
Right? How cool is that?
She's,
like, young, archivist. But she seems like a 90-year-old librarian, right? But it's the archivist, right? But she's definitely younger than I am, and
oh my god,
pretty cool. But yeah, overall, what seems the coolest about this station, and I think it still brings tons of speculation about what the hell is going to happen with it. Is it going to be an armistice zone? Is it not going to be an armistice zone?
My expectation is that a small amount of it will be an armistice zone. But it will be a respawn point for FPS and general skullduggery and piratism.
But how does that... Okay. The only way I think that can work is you have to be able to call up ships there. Is
yep.
the ships have to be located inside the station. Because if you say a small amount of it is, how can the space around it be? Or do you mean that parts of it inside... Or not?
I think parts of it, I think some of that EVA area and some of the inside-outside area that they were going down into, I think that's going to be FPS combat.
So only outside of ships then? Because I can't comprehend being able to literally wait outside the station and just be like, oh, you got in your ship? No, you didn't. You're fucking dead. You know? And I think that'll totally ruin gameplay.
I mean, it's possible that Grimhex might have gun turrets that shoot people that shoot and other people.
Hopefully. Stop. I mean, if that's the case, yeah, that would be great. And it would just deter people from doing that. But, like, for me, it just has to be an... I can't imagine that it wouldn't be an armistice. And I can only comprehend it being, like, inside, like you were saying, in that EVA area. But outside, I can't... I just don't see how it'll work and not be really trolly. You know?
Yeah, I mean,
I
that
think
is
that's
an
the
issue, isn't
biggest question about Grimhex right now that I can't wait to see get answered. And I don't think we're gonna see it get answered until we get to play with it. No?
It's annoying that they have to deal with trolls when they're trying to develop the game, isn't it? They
No, I
go,
think it's actually really
oh.
good.
Well, because, so, yeah,
Because they get to
it's nice
fix the
that.
problem before it's out.
But when it's talking about like fixing the problem at Grimhex, that station's not going to be there. I suppose they'll have similar stations elsewhere. Okay, yeah, you're probably right.
So like, yeah, it sucks, but I think it's a better situation than some games where things just happen. So, yeah.
Things just happen.
But yeah, and then we go on to this part where I thought this part was really cool where they showed the sounds. And I'm normally not that interested in the audio parts of the game.
Well, I wasn't interested in the audio much either,
Yeah.
but
This
we
was
did get to
cool.
see some extra little tidbits, didn't we? I mean, you even told me about one before we started.
Yeah, so this is something that we did on stream together, which I thought was really, really cool. And I didn't notice it at first, but on the right side, there was I'll bring it in over here. Okay, so here it is. On the right side, you can see right there the yellow asset. This is all assets, I guess, on the right side. You got Shady Alley, you got the shops, you got landing pads, a landing hub. So you do have landing pads, which seems like it's outside, so it kind of takes away from what I was saying before. You have your habitat stations, which is where you wake up in EVA tunnel. But then look, there's an EVA landing pad.
Oh.
You got the elevator shaft, back alley. But the big thing was racing tunnel. Somebody mentioned that to me while I was streaming one day. And I was like, oh, this is interesting. So I'm gonna take the video off the screen for a second here, and we're gonna put up another video from like 6 months ago. This is 6 months ago on Around the Verse, which, oh my God, I lost it. So I'm gonna have to find it real quick, which is where Jared Disco Lando Huckabee was talking to to Luke Presley about Yella and how it was going to get bigger. This was all the changes that were coming to Yella, and what I think 2.3 or something like that was going to bring. And it just brought like the speculation engine went wild, and I was like, I need to find this. So let me bring up the part of E, which I think here. All right, so let's full screen that and then back. Give it some sound. So you might not be able to hear this board, but I'll I guess tell you what he says, which is
changes and some
even I can't hear it.
reconfiguring to go
But maybe
completely
there
around
is
the
no sound.
planet.
But it might be going to the screen.
What are some other features that
Let me know if you guys can
maybe we
hear
have
that,
in
because I
mind
don't
toward
hear
the
shit.
future? I know we used Arena Commander as the test bed for so long
So
to kind of get us
professional.
here. Arena Commander
I
has a
can't hear
couple
it. Oh no.
modes.
On the stream, you
Vandal
might be able to hear
Swarm
it.
is kind
Okay,
of
can hear it on stream.
it's in Crusader in a bit when you go to different comlinks and you get attacked by AI stuff. What about something like racing? How could
I've heard
something
this
like
plenty.
racing be
And
integrated into
I can maybe
Crusader?
read his lips.
So, I mean, something that I have been thinking about recently, and we're going to try and get in at some point,
It's
is
on the list.
it's on the list. But I mean, we have a universe, so there are so many things on the list. It's choosing which to get in first. Like, we're looking at cargo, we're looking at all these mechanics that aren't just dogfighting. So racing would be up there for me because we've got the asteroid, say, around Yella, or we've got all these really cool asteroid fields that are out in space. Just having you race around that thing would be fantastic. I know people are already doing
And this
it,
was 6 months
just
ago.
giving them some way to actually measure that.
Measure it,
Yeah.
legitimize it,
Yeah,
I guess.
exactly. Yeah. And creating a mission is quite, it's a quite straightforward process. So I think we'd be able to definitely get something in there for them. at the moment, though, what I was saying was,
I don't know if they mentioned
with
it
us increasing
yet.
The size of Yala,
I'm trying to read his
that increases the size of the asteroid field.
So,
and I don't think
he
anyone
talks about racing. And this was 6 months ago. So when I saw that, I was like, wow, they thought about this long ago. Mm-hmm. So we're going to get some sort of racing in the mini PU in Yella. It sounds like it's going to go into Grimhex.
It would be so cool if that's true. I'd love
that's
unofficial
wild.
Metered races. I think that's a great idea. That would get me into racing. That would get me into racing.
Absolutely. But the only thing is how is it going to work? Is it going to bring you into an instance? How does a race start?
No, they can't. They can't bring you into an instance. This game's not about that, is it?
Yeah.
It's not about those instances, so...
Now, the coolest thing was this gentleman over here, Luke Presley, was in the chat when I was doing this. And it's not just speculation, guys. He literally said, they're onto something here. And then just didn't say anything for the rest of the time. And just left. So, I don't think it's just speculation. I think it is a thing, and I think we're going to have to make our own races.
We are, however, let's make it clear, we are speculating, and it could be a big troll.
I don't think it's a troll. I think it's a thing that's going to be in. It just, come on, it says racing tunnel. He talked about racing. He said we're on to things. But I don't think it's going to be, like, its own instance. I don't think you're going to go in and press a button, and it's going to pull you into an instance, like, your own little thing, and then you're going to be able to race. I think it's going to be like, hey, everybody line up. Let's race.
Someone just put in the chat, the game's not about instances. It's not supposed to be about instances, and it won't be eventually. So if they did separate instances within instances, I think that's just going the wrong direction. So I doubt that would happen.
Yeah. Oh, maybe betting. That's what somebody put in the chat, which would be really cool. But the thing that gets me the most excited is I think we're going to finally see our weapons off racing for the first time. Right?
Oh,
there's no, how can they keep you from having guns? Well, it might be an armistice zone, but it might not, right? So it's interesting to see maybe certain parts of the racetrack will be weapons off. When you get out of a certain area away from the station and go through a ring, then boom, the weapons are off and people just start firing at each other. I just, now we're speculating, but the fact that I think there will be racing as a part of Grimhex, I don't think that's a speculation. I think that's all but confirmed. But how it's going to work is pure speculation.
I hope it's guns blaze and then some. And it's how do they meter that? How do they measure you're actually doing a race?
That's the thing that I just have no clue. Right? It's hard to comprehend how all that's going to work. But everything they've implemented so far has made sense, and I'm willing to relax and see how it's going to just. Wait for it and see how it's going to be. But I think that's really cool. And I don't think many people noticed that they noticed the ships and some other things on the screens and stuff like that. But I don't think they noticed the actual racing thing. And then I pulled it full circle and then even got it confirmed by the director of Star Citizen Live, the guy who's literally making it happen, kind of confirmed it for us. I think it's a pretty exciting thing, and I'm looking forward to seeing what's going to happen with it. I don't know exactly what's going to happen with it, but we know it's going to be some sort of a thing, which is
cool.
Yeah. I think this was my favorite part of the whole ATV. I don't know about you, Board, but my favorite part was the UI change. I thought that was the cool.
Over the bet. Are you trolling me?
No, I really like the UI changes.
I do, but they were so short. It would be like saying, I tell you I really liked. I liked them when they were talking about the network problems, which was all of 2 seconds.
No, that was 2 seconds. This wasn't that short. Come on.
It was pretty short. I mean,
yeah,
come on,
but I mean, it's a Mobi glass. It's not the biggest thing. The Bengal's really cool, but I think the Bengal's something like, are we even going to fly that ship?
Okay,
right?
Okay.
This
in
is
chat,
literally
in
everything
chat.
You're going to be touching all the time.
If you liked the Bengal segment more, put one. If you liked the Mobi Glass UI segment, whatever Twerk's talking about, put two. And remember that one is the right answer.
And if anybody puts one, I'm going to... No. No, but I think the UI, it's something that you're going to be touching and playing with constantly at all times. And changes that they're making to it, I think, are really cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely important, and it was very impressive. But we've seen some cool, impressive art that's very similar to this quite a long time ago as well. And I think they're having... I think... How soon do you think we're going to get UI changes like this?
These were all clearly just images. They weren't, like... They were even looking at images when they were discussing them. And that could have been staged for the show or whatever. But
people are agreeing with you at the moment, Spike. It makes me feel sick a little bit in my stomach.
Yeah, I mean, think about how important this is. Think about how crappy the Mobi Glass UI is right now. It's not that intuitive. It doesn't do things like routes, which is what we're looking at now, right? It doesn't do all that stuff. It doesn't estimate how much fuel you're going to use and how many waypoints and how much time it's going to take and the distance. And it's got all the history and overview, which is goes into something that's pretty funny. I was like, oh, it looks like they wrote in German on the right side. And everyone goes, you're an idiot. That's lorem ipsum, which is literally just a placeholder for everything. And everybody has literally been trolling me and just spamming lorem, that whole thing. They just literally spam that whole thing in the chat over and over again for days.
My speakers just suddenly attacked me audibly. So they have used... I believe the description of the Banu Merchantman for some of their text as well. Banu Merchant and Sail Page.
Yeah, but I don't know. They're definitely mock-ups, so I don't think we're going to see this that soon. Right? But I don't know. For me, I really thought that this was my favorite part. I think I've seen enough spaceships. And also to think that you're an Idris. Just remember that. A part of this UI, you're in an Idris when doing this. So take
you're an Idris.
Look. You're an Idris, man. So I don't know, but it's cool. And then you get a sense of maybe what the holo table is gonna look like too, right?
Yeah,
which they kind of show us here.
I'm looking forward to.
And there's lots of stats.
Horses. I'm an information man. I need lots of more information, the better. And getting the UI right and the way it looks at the moment, that looks awesome.
Yeah.
Doesn't it?
Damn it. Stats. Move your fucking hand out of the way. He keeps waving his hand in front of it. But yeah, it should be really cool. So, I don't know. I thought this was the coolest thing. I think you see a lot of components and just being able to click them and highlight them and take them off and put them on. It's so much more intuitive for the way that they're doing that stuff. Right, and then they have all these bits of information below, and it seems like there's so many that it's some of them say placeholder stat number 4. Like they don't even know they have so much space down there that they don't even know what they're going to put there for a stat. Yeah, okay, yeah, guys, yeah, this is an English only channel. Can you please not put that German in the chat?
Wow. Wow.
But yeah, I don't know. I thought this was cool, and then obviously, the coolest part was the bank. So we can get to your favorite part now, board game. All right, it's here.
I mean, I didn't see the results of those ones and twos, but I just assume that people agreed with me.
yeah, because you're so smart.
Yeah,
you're always right. But I don't know. I think the Bengal was really cool, but. For me, it's a giant ship. Are we going to see it that much? Are we going to use it that much? I don't know.
Well, it's integral to Squadron 42.
Of course. But are we ever going to fly the thing? How much are we going to walk around it? Maybe a lot. I don't know. But it just didn't, for whatever reason, it didn't get me going like something like the Mobi Glass that I'm going to use literally so much in the game going forward. But obviously, this thing is stupid huge, amazing.
It represents the engine, the entire game engine working. So it's instances in instances, effectively, because it's ships within ships that are all their own separate gravity generating instances, sort of.
I mean, and I just paused it on the part. They're literally pulling up a Retaliator, and it looks like it's nothing. Like, that Retaliator looks like it's a tiny little ship. Because it is tiny compared to this giant bangle.
I just saw something that I didn't notice before.
What's that?
Carry on talking. I'm just going to see if I'm right.
Okay.
I'll link it if I am.
But I think that was probably one of my favorite parts of the bangle, was just showing the Retaliator coming up and just showing how small it looks inside of that massive ship and all those Gladiuses. And it's, yeah. I can't wait to just look over this overhang that we're watching now and just watch ships come and go, right? I think that'll be something that'll be really cool. And now, one thing that they did mention, though, which is something that you said earlier, Bord, is that this is like the example of things working, is, yeah, they got the art asset in, but I don't think they've quite figured out with 100% certainty how to get this working completely. Is kind of the, they were like, we're on the right track, we're going to do it, it's going to be a challenge. Is like a lot of the things that they were saying, and I don't know, that makes me a little bit uneasy about that 2016 Squadron 42 release. I think this is the most mind-blowing thing, is that's a saber, you can't even see it.
I still feel in my heart of hearts that we're going to see Squadron 42 at the end of 2016, possibly, if there is some delay, it will be early, very very early 2017. That's just my feeling from what we can see.
I don't know. Like, I think, and I'm okay if that happens. Like, look at something like No Man's Sky. Hey, man, we're going to be delayed for a couple months. And we're like, all right.
they did get quite a few death threats when they did that.
Did they?
Yeah. A reasonable amount of death threats.
Really sad that people get that upset.
Wait. I don't know if they're genuinely upset, if they have issues, or they're just trolling. But, I mean,
most likely just trolling. I think people are more passionate about this game than anything. Oh, shit, I never noticed that. The light's coming on.
Is there people
to let you know it's okay to take off? Oh, my God. Can I watch that again?
At the top of the bangle, at the end of the runway, for a second, I thought I saw a
That is so cool.
What's the repair ship called?
The Argo.
No.
Oh, the Anvil.
Crucible. Thank you.
There you go.
I thought it was a crucible. It's just like a little command station.
Yeah, and the Retribution's like way huger than this thing, right? This thing's amazing.
So I will be doing a video on the Retribution very soon, because I looked through loads of the monthly reports and lots of the other concept pictures. There's quite a lot of artwork for the Retribution and the Skydock.
Skydock? Oh, the thing where they're building the Retribution in?
Yeah. So there's quite a lot there. And then on some dev screens, you can see that it's the Skydock, but you can also see bits of the Retribution. And it looks like the Retribution is been shot a lot. Spoilers.
I wonder how far along that is.
Yeah, I mean, some of the ships, I think, like the huge ships, they might just build the exteriors of, I'm thinking. Because we might not ever be meant to get into them in the first episode of Squadron 42.
Yeah.
So they could build the exterior and then build the interior later. Would be my guess. Obviously, again, just a guess.
Let me pause you there real quick, because we're kind of getting to the question part, and we only have a couple questions. Guys, if you want to ask us any questions, usually at the end of the stream, we take a few minutes, and usually we kind of mention that a few times, but we have so much fun stuff to talk about that we didn't get a chance to. Exclamation point question in chat, and you can fill out the form there, and it'll pop up in a little document for us to answer. So right now we have a couple, but we'd like a few more so we can end the podcast not early. So yeah, go ahead, Boredom.
can't remember what I was talking about, so it wouldn't have been important anyway. It's just been me rambling on about some stupid subject.
Yeah, well, I guess we could start with a couple questions, and hopefully a few more will come in. This one, and I won't be putting them on screen or anything, because I just... too much going on.
But mate, we had that episode where we were talking about Well, I didn't particularly care about production values so much.
Yeah.
And this is proof of that.
Yeah. So, this one is from the... And I can't pronounce names. The Lactosinator. Okay. And it's for you and I. Do you know where the data center that we will connect for the PU is, or do they have a few geolocations? If they do, do you know where and how the game chooses your...
I don't actually know how it's done at the moment.
They do things in the cloud. So it's wherever the Google Cloud server... They use Google servers, and it's wherever those servers are located. I think the only place they don't have them is in Australia. I think the Australians have to connect somewhere in Asia.
Up and working now, are they?
No, okay. So right now, this was something that we had talked to John Erskine, who's one of like the leads in Austin when we were out there. And that was one of the questions that we asked. And he said, currently, it doesn't make sense to have local servers for like UK or, Eastern Europe or Western Europe and things like that at the moment, because there's just not a big enough player base playing the alpha. But those will come online when the game is filling up. For the moment, the current services are in the United States. So if you're in Europe, you're connecting to the cloud servers in the US. I don't know where they're located in the US, but that's where they're located at the moment. And it will expand out into all the big countries and things like that, and you will connect to those at some point. At the moment...
And the little countries too, guys, don't worry.
Yeah, don't worry about
the UK. Little countries. We're not part of Europe anymore. We just moved out, mate.
Yep.
Just
up and left.
Up and left, mate. It's gone. See you later.
This one's just for you, Board. Hey, Board Gamer, are you going to the Gamescom?
No, but I will be covering it from my seat pretty much here, as live as I can. Any YouTuber or streamer I can connect to there, I'll try and get them to film live and stuff. And
so you want to do like Periscope or whatever?
Yeah, that's the one, Periscope. Okay. But I'll be doing... literally as I know stuff happens minute by minute, either videos or I might even stream myself at the same time. So, yeah, but do something.
They're doing those pop-up events talking about. So they said they're going to release a ship there. That would be crazy if somebody can like stream it somehow. But it sounds like they're just
going to steal my ideas back. You steal my ideas.
They're going to be at a fucking bar or something. So I don't know how that's really going to work.
We'll see. No, I'm not going to be there.
You would think, because you're not that far away, that that's one of the ones that you would have decided to go.
So, I mean, I loved going to CitizenCon last year, but at the same time, I wish I'd stayed home because there was so much to get onto my channel straight away.
Yeah.
So, and I'm always worried that I'm going to get panicky when I'm away from home. So another country, probably not the best idea.
All right, and then this one is from Michael. He says, I can't see the bangle in the PU in a working state. It's too big.
Nope, neither can I, mate. It's not there yet.
It will take up too much data. Can you please discuss how they will make this happen and make it work? I mean, they did say it would get in the game. Right?
At the moment, I believe they said...
it would be in the PU in some...
Yeah, but at the moment, I think they said there was a lot of head scratching.
Yeah, and that's just to get it into a single player game. Right? So I really just... I agree. I agree with you, Mike. I don't see it being...
I agree with you, Mike.
I agree with you. No, I said Mike, not mate.
You did. They're just like first name places with them.
Well, my name's Mike, too. But I agree. It's so big. Like, I can't even comprehend the Idris being in the game right now. Right? Like, look at what happens when a Starfarer loads up. Everything freezes. And we know they're working on that, and it's definitely going to get better. And I think we'll see it to where we can see an Idris come into the game. But the Bangle is mind-blowing. Just mind-blowing how big that thing is. There was a picture. Did you see this picture going around with the Bangle? That it's literally the size of Port Olisar, like the landing pads?
So they need to get a top-down version of that as well. We need to.
They did.
I want a better comparison. Oh, was there?
They did get a top-down version. It goes from A to D. You know how D is straight across from A? It is length of A to D. That's how long the ship is. So landing pads A, like straight across, like the tip of the Bengal starts at the far end of A and ends at the far end of D.
I'm not sure that.
That's how big that ship. Fucking huge. Fucking huge.
I mean, yeah, it's certainly big. It's just it's the level. It's the multiple levels and stuff that make it big to me, rather than its length. If you see what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like the Banu Merchantman. I don't think the Banu Merchantman's going to be that long, but it's probably the interior.
It's going to have a lot of levels.
Yeah, it's going to be super wide, super tall. It's like a giant flying beautiful box.
Yeah. So that one's kind of answered. And then you got VCQBR asked, what do you think of the cargo? Will you buy one? And its modules as well. What ships do you think the Argo will fit in? So a few questions there. What do you think about the Argo, first off?
I'll definitely buy one because it looks like a mini utility ship.
It looks like it's going to be cheap, which is why I'll buy one. I don't see the point of it, though. Right?
So if you read the original kind of lore and blurb about them, they're supposed to be there to rescue pilots that have escape podded and that sort of stuff.
Okay.
But they're also there for utility and moving cargo around, moving pilots from ship to ship, that sort of stuff as well. So we're getting three modules for them, basically.
Yes, that's like, I wonder what they're going to be. That's the most interesting part about this sale, I get, is they said we're going to get three modules.
I'm assuming now, cargo / people carrier
should be one,
repair,
yeah,
and salvage. And the salvage one will also probably be for rescuing crew.
Okay, but when they say that those modules are going to be in, they're not going to be functioning. We don't have any of those mechanics in the game. They're not going to. I feel like they would tell us if they were going to debut with that little ship. Right? So that's what makes me think, like, no, those modules won't be in. And then you just. And the only one I can think of was the one that you said, was the cargo transport one. But then they said there would be a couple that we might get. And then you just kind of, you know, sparked my creativity or my mind a little bit with the search and rescue. Because they had mentioned, like, a long, long time ago, I think it was Chris that mentioned it, which Chris just says stuff sometimes, I think. That he hopes will be done, but has no idea how long it's going to take because, you know, these things take time, but he decides
it's
to
my
just...
my game, and I'll have search and rescue if I want to.
No, but, like, he just said something about, like, beacons, right? Like, do you remember that, like, a while back? Like, oh, we're going to be able to have our own distress beacons, and you can spoof them, and people will, you know, but, like, who knows when the fuck that was going to come in. But maybe that's one of those things that they're not telling us about 2.5. Like, where, you know, how they put a patch out and they tell us, oh, yeah, you're going to get Grim Hex and you're going to get a flyable Reliant. But then they don't tell us about all these other, like, quote-unquote minor changes, which turn out to be, like, pretty fucking crazy. Maybe that's one of them. And maybe it's a search and rescue type thing. I don't know. But it's really hard for me to figure out what these other modules would be.
I mean, so they just don't do anything. They have to, maybe they just don't do anything yet.
Maybe they have to be
utility-based for me to serve aboard an Idris, to help
absolutely
the Idris function.
And repair makes the most sense. Salvage, those all make sense.
I'm assuming that salvage would be like, for me, salvage would be search and rescue with the ability to grab shit.
So, yeah.
Effectively salvage.
Yeah. But you wouldn't bring it into its cargo bay or anything. I feel like you would just, it would have little claws and bring them, and you would land on a ship and just
light them down. Arms.
Did anyone see the gif of a crab eating a cherry? Eating a cherry. Little crab. So that's what I think of the Argo. A little crab eating a cherry. What ships do we think it'll fit in, though? Obviously, it's meant for the Idris, but I guess what he's really asking is, what smaller ships do we think it's going to fit in? Are we going to be able to carry? I think we'll be able to carry around on our Starfarer, but do we think Freelancer, Constellation?
No, so I think it will fit into larger ships. I think it's supposed to be a
capital size
service ship. Yes. Yeah. You might be able to get it into like the Carrack, maybe, and ships that can hold those.
I think for sure the Starfarer.
Maybe.
Think about it. They're fitting M50s.
It's not meant to hold ships, though. It's a cargo bay. You might be able to get dragonflies in there.
Oh, that's a good point.
It might not be meant to hold that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Because I know. Yeah, we'll have to kind of see. A lot of the other ships as well, like the Banu can probably fit quite large ships in it, but it's whether it's gonna, it might be have really tight bottlenecks inside, so mm-hmm. that ships, like even the Dragonfly might not be suitable in the Banu Merchantmen. They don't know, we don't know, because they haven't built them yet.
Yeah.
And they literally, after they've built them, they'll go, do they fit? Yeah, let's do something about that. Yeah, so we've got another pocket carrier we can sell.
Yeah. All right, so next question is from Uber Nerd, and he asks us, do you think that Microtech and Hurston, which are both planets in the Stanton system that will eventually expand out, we're currently around Stator, which is also in the Stanton system, we're going to expand out and hopefully get all those planets pretty soon. Will they both be explorable planets? Will they be armistice zones on the planets, or will we be able to draw weapons and have FPS battles on the planet? That's a lot of questions again, but we'll start with, do you think Microtech and Hurston will both be fully explorable planets? I guess that would mean that they would have to be procedural, be fully explored.
Yeah.
But do you think they'll be procedural planets?
I think they'll be procedural planets, although I think people overuse the term procedural to possibly mean something else. But I think they'll be procedural planets with obviously handcrafted landing zones,
mm-hmm.
And in some of those landing zones, or most of the landing zone, there will be armistice zones. That'd be my thought.
Yeah, and I definitely think, like, if you look at Area 18 and R-Corp, those back alleys, those aren't going to be armistice. I think there'll be armistice zones around the main areas and around the shops, but once you go down those alleys, I think they're going to pull that armistice icon.
Yeah, so they might treat it differently. They might say,
I think you'll get that on most landing zones.
I think they might go, there's no armistice anywhere. This is a possibility. You know
what I mean?
Mm-hmm. But
I don't think
when
so.
You go to those flat planets, they take all your weapons away. So you'd have to sneak weapons in or something like that. So
there's been loads of discussion about this from the devs. Like, if you fired on somebody a few times, you might not be allowed to bring a weapon on, right? So you're allowed to, like, kill people a few times, and then that's it. I don't think those planets are going to be fully explored. I don't think all the planets are going to be. I think there's going to be just some who can explore the landing zone, and they will cut us off. Just for the sake of getting the game out. I think some will be procedural, some will not be. And to be honest, I think Microtech, Hurston, R-Corp, and possibly Crusader, which Crusader is going to be weird because it's like a cloudy city that I think it'll be more procedural, I don't think those will be fully explorable planets, to be honest with you. That's just my opinion. I think it'll take too long to do all of that. As far as armistice zones, I think I kind of went into what I thought about it. If you go down a dark alley, that armistice icon will come right off, and you'll be able to do whatever you want. And will we be able to draw weapons and have an FPS battle on the planet? In those areas, potentially, and on some procedural planets or some more open planets or in outlaw-y areas, maybe the whole planet could be a war zone. Who knows?
Well,
that'd be really cool.
We know that on the Nyx landing zone,
mm-hmm.
the plan there is to, as you get deeper into Nyx when they eventually have finished it, that it becomes more and more criminal,
yeah.
and then eventually getting to the mining areas where criminals hide.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming that the plan there is for that to be very, very not armistice zone.
Yeah. And I think the same, like I said before, with Area 18, if you go down those dark alleys and things get seedier, it's going to be, I think they're going to remove that armistice.
I think we're going to have to see how they're going to deal with Grimhex, because I think Grimhex will be a good indication.
A good point, because it's got to be an armistice zone, but it also can't be an armistice zone. It's such a weird, weird bit of gameplay. I'm really looking forward to that implementation. This one's directed at you from IDD KFA Board Gamer. And he says, what makes you so positive that Squadron 42 will make the 2016 release date?
Because, I mean, I'm watching the progress, and they said it was going to be released in 2016 in Gamescom.
You got faith?
Yeah. Not Gamescom.
More, you just have faith.
No, I don't have faith. I now understand that if they give any form of date, that they're normally pretty happy that that's going to be the right date. Now, if there is any delays, I hope they're upfront about them. I hope they talk to us about them. And I hope they explain why. And I'd kind of be reasonably happy with that. But I do expect if there is any delays, then it would be early 2017.
Yeah. All right, now I'm going to leave this one to you, Board. This is directed to all of us. I just don't have enough experience with it. What can CIG learn from Pokemon? It's from VCQBR. I don't know if I said
that. Augmented reality games are cool. Sometimes people can get overly addicted by stuff. More microtransactions mean more money.
So how would you implement a Pokemon Go style microtransaction into?
So I wouldn't do anything like. Obviously, I wouldn't want to do anything like that because I think that is not the way Star Citizen is going. But if I can do a lot of cool stuff on my phone while I'm at work. So if I can manage with the new communication system, Orcs 2.0, but if I can also do some character and some gameplay management from my phone, I don't want to play the entire game from my phone, that'd be madness, but if I can do some bits and bobs from my phone that keep me addicted, that when I get home, I play.
Okay, so cool. Like a mini game or even like cargo management or anything. That you can do.
Getting your ships ready for the evening. Just go bam, 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 bam. Got all my ships outfitted.
Yeah.
A load of money's just come in from the NPCs that I asked to do stuff before I left. And then you could do contract management. If they give you enough to do on your phone that doesn't make it that you can just entirely play the game from your phone, then I think that would be cool. That will keep people addicted.
I think one of the things that they mentioned that I thought was kind of interesting is that you could be playing the game board. You're in-game playing, flying around, and I could be on my cell phone at work and say, how's the mining operation going? And I could type that, and it will get to you in-game is what they're making it sound like from some of the things that they've talked about, and then you can interact back with me from the game. It's also something that I thought was really
cool. I mean, that is cool. I like augmented reality, and I like it when they splice them together and you get... I have to see how it's implemented, though. I mean, it's all great ideas. Depends how it's implemented.
Always. So this one is from Krimis CYR, and it's directed to all of us. How do you think they will go about making creatures on planets? Do you think they'll have a set number of types and then do reskinning of them? Or do you think that there will be a system like Spore where then they'll be evolving in their environments?
I don't know. I'm not sure if they'd be entirely procedural. They might be partially modular because we know that some of the NPCs and stuff that they do for humans, they'll be relatively modular. Like they'll just go, this guy has got this head with this body, these legs, this clothes, blah, 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 blah. Splice them together, procedure generate the NPCs. Boom, done.
Yeah.
For aliens, obviously a bit different.
Yeah, like not Banu and stuff.
Well, you might get it for Banu, but you would get it with Banu style guide. So the Banu would be done in the same way that humans are done, but for the Banu. So they'd look normal for Banu, and
like they'd have
different.
Banu traders, Banu pilots, Banu.
But literally, that all of the
types.
Banu would look unique.
Yeah, hopefully.
The idea, because the idea
just
is
play
that
with some numbers, yeah.
Yeah, it
at some point
numbers, does lots of little different bits and bobs.
Yeah.
So when they do that with aliens on planets, I don't know. I mean,
It really, do you know what it really comes down to for me? How many of these planets are going to be sneaking in for us to explore? Or,
sneaking in.
Well, you know what I mean? Like, the planets that aren't actually in the map that we're going to find might be some interesting things. But at the same time, they also talked about us collecting fish.
Because that's a good point. Because, okay, I've got, say I've got a carrot, yeah?
Yeah.
Day one, I'm going to play for like 24 hours straight because I've been waiting for Star Citizen to be released and I like coffee.
Fuck, I'm going to play for... I'm going to be up 72 hours. It's going to be ridiculous.
Yeah, but you fly straight through the jump points and everywhere to the edge of the known galaxy and then go on.
Yeah.
There has to be a reasonable amount of exploration outside of what we know.
Yeah, of course.
So, but we don't really know how much more there's going to be, do we?
We don't know much about that. And I like that. And that's a good thing. I think that's going to be the part of the game that I hope they don't tell us much about it. I hope we have to find
So the issue is, okay, so from the exploration point of view, I don't want to know where stuff is when the game goes live.
Hell no.
I want that to be kind of secret stuff. But we need to hold them accountable and, not accountable, but we need to be part of the development process. We need to have our input in that. That's what we want from Star Citizen. We want our input.
I think we'll get that. I mean, we're going to see the...
They don't tell us too much. We won't.
Well, okay, but... We have to give them a chance on that because we're still just in our one system. Or not even our one system, we're in our one planetary area. So I think they'll tell us, I think we'll be a part of the how exploration works coming. I think even when we see the new, when Stanton expands into all the planets and we're going to be landing on a procedural planet and then who knows, you know, I think the first implementation of procedural planets is going to be very basic. We're just going to walk around. It's going to be like, oh, cool. But as it progresses, who knows? We might see little rats or like a little bit of water with a fish that you can, you know, press F and pick them up.
Wildlife and the flora and fauna being reasonably unique to each planet or each system is just mind-boggling.
And I think it's a lot of work.
Oh, God, yeah.
I think they'll probably procedural.
But, now I'm actually,
but with a lot of hands-on.
I'm really looking forward to No Man's Sky.
Yeah,
to some extent.
Have
that really soon.
So well, spory. Yeah, what is the actual release date? It's like August 8th or 9th?
Yeah, it's early.
August 8th, 9th, or 10th. It's early August. First week of August, second week of August. But yeah, it that kind of stuff, it's going to... What I think No Man's Sky is going to do is going to get me excited for exploring.
Okay. Yeah. See, for me, it's going to be a mixture of Spore, GTA, and exploration in space. I think it's going to be a lot more simple than people expect. But I do think it's going to be a nice chill-out game.
I think it's going to be more detailed than people.
Oh, do you think so?
Yeah.
Oh, see, this is why we should talk more to work on a video. We have different expectations.
Like in Vampire, all your views.
Yeah, you're whatever, mate.
All right, so this is our second-to-last question. There was one thing that we kind of missed that we might want to touch on before we go.
Yep.
This is from the Lactacinator again. Do you think the amount of info we're getting now is short-lived until ATV 100-4, or are most of the design things reacting alpha beta? Not really sure what he's asking, but I think for me, what I'm taking from that is, do you think this ATV 100 celebration is so big and so awesome that anything that comes after it is not going to compare?
No, I think this is...
Do you think this is the start of something amazing, or do you think this is going to hurt the content going forward?
No. So I definitely think that... I don't think we're going to see huge, huge, big things like we did in Point 2, in Episode 2, that 100 special in... 3 and 4, but I do think the stuff in the future that they do, the content they do, is going to be of a similar style, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah. So I mean, they had really good cameras. They had the actual gameplay, the actual things overlaying the people talking about them, which plus 1,000. That's really, really good. And as long as they keep doing that, I'm okay with stuff. Okay, if it's a 5-minute segment and it's, you know, our ATV is 15-20 minutes long, if they continue to do ATV, sound like they're gonna break them up into little pieces. I don't like personally, I like the idea of hopefully they do something similar to this, like every 4 weeks it kind of wraps around, and maybe they even take a time to go out to like behavior, and those are the guys that are doing the environments, right? Or you know, out to somewhere else where, I don't know, there's like another studio in Montreal that they're that does things well, that they can show what they're working on. Like you can show the website stuff off from Turbulent, right? So you can go like, just, I know it's going to take some development dollars away, or maybe that's from the subscriber money. I don't know what money they use, but taking some money and flying guys like Jared or Tyler out to those studios, or Thomas Hennessy or whoever, out to those studios to get these hits from them, and do them weekly. Whereas, you know, we're not going to hear from the Texas studio for another 4 or 5 weeks. We're not going to hear from the UK studio for another 4 or 5 weeks, and they get to show us the progress that they make, right? So they have all this time to build up and present something, and present it for of the quality that we saw it this week. Maybe not the level of amazing of what they showed us, but the level of quality, which is
yes. But also, good. We're going to start to see little more sneakier peekies. We're going to start to see a mixture of quite raw content.
Yeah.
We're going to get to talk to people we want to listen to, but also that high kind of pre-rendered kind of stuff when they do those the sneak peeks and around and ship shapes and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I'm liking the mix. I'm liking the mix.
Absolutely. I don't know if they're going to be able to keep that up going forward, but I really hope they can. And like, I think they really want to, and one of the things that I think, I don't know if everybody else noticed this, but I noticed this myself, is they've always thanked subscribers, but they've never really said, hey, we really need some subscribers to be able to do this content the way we want. And the last few weeks, I've kind of heard that, as like maybe an underlying tone of like, we want to do really great things with this content, but it's going to take a little bit more. And, you know, to maybe have some of the people that unsubscribed to come back, and, or, you know, like, I think this past few weeks of content has, I guess, re-solidified my trust with how good the content that they can do. I think it's really made it solid for me, and like, I never planned on getting rid of my subscription anyway, but it's nice to see, the work that they're doing and where they can go. I don't know. And I guess the last thing that we want to talk about is multi-factor authentication, Pop.
Something oh, yeah.
Talking about earlier.
Do a video on that at some point.
Yeah, I would do it soon. Because it's pretty... Happened yesterday. It's a pretty big deal, right? Have you done it, Board?
Yeah, so my main account has it on now because...
Mine still doesn't. I needed a break. I took a nice break.
There was a lot going on with it, rather more than I thought, because there's like, you can get temporary codes and stuff like that, and you can print out extra codes if you're on the move, and there was lots of stuff going on there.
Oh, that's really cool. So it's more in depth than I'm signing in, I get a text on my phone.
It requires explanation.
Okay, well, just to cut you off a second, the damn shames said MFA ASAP. It's in now, buddy. So just so you know, it's a thing. It exists. In. So
it does indeed.
We don't need it as soon as possible. It's here now. Yes, if you guys want to, or he might be telling me to do it now. So if you guys want to hack, bring it. Better hurry up, because as soon as the podcast is over, I'm adding it. I just haven't had time. So, yeah, but that's a thing that's happening. So if you haven't done multi-factor authentication and you want to protect your accounts, I mean, these are more valuable MMO accounts than I think any game out there right now. I don't think you find a WoW account as valuable as some people's Star Citizen accounts. I don't think you're finding any MMO accounts as valuable as some of these, just for the simple... people selling their ships and all that crazy shit. So
I think there's some pretty valuable Eve accounts out there.
There might be some valuable Eve accounts, but like, we're talking guys like Clifford and some of these guys. Like, do you think that there's Eve accounts that have spent this much money on this game?
No, but I do think that there are some CEOs of some corps in a that have access to so much ISK
that it's really that valuable. Has
real, yeah, yeah. Oh god, yeah.
Okay. I never thought about EVE as that valuable. I don't think WoW accounts could be.
No, I don't think WoW accounts, even if you had some of the rarest stuff.
I sold an Ultima Online account for.
You were really into EVE Online, weren't you?
Ultima Online.
Ultima Online.
I still am.
Are you getting back into it?
Wait, I would like to. Here's the problem. It kind of sucks. The problem with me getting back into it is the guys that I play with. They're really, really vulgar. They tell really nasty jokes that are super inappropriate, and they're the best players in the game, and they were fun to play with, but I don't have that much time off stream to play. I would love to play it on stream, but I can't trust them that I wouldn't get banned. And I did go back and play, and since I've been away and I went back and like some of the jokes they made, I was just kind of like,
jeez, yeah.
No, like what the fuck? So that's one of the reasons why I haven't gotten back into it. There's one guy that I play with that I think if we can just play him and I, it would be nice, but it's hard to play with just two people. In PvP situations. It's nice to have multiple like 4 or 5 plus.
Okay. I'd look at Ultima Online again if you started doing
it. Dude, that game is so fucking good. It's so good. but yeah, I think we're gonna end it here. I think we ended just about on time. So, Storis, we missed you, buddy. We're glad you're okay, and it was just an oversleep day. And we look forward to having you back next week, man. Hopefully we get to see more Grimhex and you get to tell us all your feelings about it. And yeah, I hope you guys all enjoyed this kind of impromptu. I threw this together in 20 minutes podcast. I think it was fun. I hope everybody enjoyed themselves. And yeah, we'll see you all next week on WTFosaurus's channel. But before we go, Bord, what are you up to? What are you up to this week? What are we doing?
Well, obviously, personally, I'm going to be playing a reasonable amount of Pokemon because I'm a no-life loser. But
I think that game's really fun. It's not a no-life loser thing. It's actually fun, and it gets you out of the house. You get some sun. I think that's really good for your health as well.
I mean, yeah, but I'm playing it like a proper grinder. I'm working out the most efficient route, so I have got to move the least amount.
But you're still outside.
Occasionally, yeah.
Outside is good.
Outside is good, I've heard.
Yeah.
Do like to try and avoid it if I can.
Yeah. I love being outside, man. If I can be outside all the time, I would be.
I'll be doing a video on the monthly report, just breaking that all down. Bam, 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 bam.
Nice. That's one thing we didn't talk much about today. But
that's good because I haven't actually finished reading it yet.
Okay. So maybe we can catch up a bit on it next week. There was some cool stuff in there.
Yeah, well, there's little tiny teasers and stuff with 2.5 and what they're working on at the moment. But not
as teasery as most monthly reports, I noticed.
Yeah, I think they're holding back a lot for Gamescom, maybe. That's my feeling. But we'll talk about that more next week, I suppose, because we haven't got enough time now anyway.
So
I've got loads of videos planned. People have been watching my channel. The last 2 days, I've been quite lazy, and I did. I put up some of the clips that I'm using for some other projects, which you will see pretty soon. And I hope people enjoy the stuff I've got planned. So, if you want Star Citizen based things, stay tuned for my channel. It's the best.
Yeah, I mean, and as far as me, before we get going, I kind of lost my mind a little bit this morning. I just
smashed.
Yeah, I can't. I've played so much. I've played so much 2-4, I kind of broke down a little bit today. And I was just like, I can't do this. And I started playing Homeworld Remastered. And
such a good game.
I'm finding that out very quickly. It's really, really enjoyable. So I think I'm going to be taking a bit of a break from Star Citizen. I want to play Star Citizen when I want to play Star Citizen. I think that's where I'm going to go with it for right now. I love talking about Star Citizen. So if there's a day that you know, there's interesting things to talk about. Like, for example, tomorrow on tomorrow's podcast, or tomorrow's, it'll essentially be a podcast, I think. Tomorrow's stream, I think we're just going to watch ATV. We're going to talk about it. I'm going to hang out in the game and just kind of chill and chat about the game. It's my favorite thing to do, is to just talk with the community about what we just saw and what's coming and all those things. And I think that's where I'm gonna lie for a little while. I just couldn't do it today. I don't know. I couldn't do it today. And I told the guys this morning, this is the first time that I didn't want to stream, because I knew I was going to stream Star Citizen, and I was just like, I don't want to do that. And I think it's, so, and everybody told me, like,
out sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah. And I burnt out, and everyone was like, dude, we love to hang out and just chill. So let's just do that. And it was cool. So yeah, I don't stream for a job. It's not, you know, I'm not doing it to make money, so I might as well just enjoy myself.
If I didn't enjoy doing Star Citizen, I would do another topic while I was bored. Like, I would go more into hardware, I would explore other areas of something. I'd do a game review. But for me, it's a little different. You stream, you need to be enthusiastic about what you're doing at the time.
And if you're, so if not, you're not enthusiastic at that time, it's, and everybody notices, you know, they feel it, and it affects how everyone's feeling. So.
Yeah. So play what you want, boo, bro.
You just call me your boo. Hey, boo, boo.
You're my boo.
You're my boo, too. You're my boo thing. All right. On that note, guys, where can we find you, Board Gamer?
At Board Gamer UK on all of the social medias. Just look there on the Twitters, on the YouTubes. Hello.
Hello. Hey, boo thing. You guys can find me at twitch.tv/Torque17 and at Torque17 Gaming on Twitter and YouTube. I actually put up a video of you, me, and Soros all playing in the PU on Sunday, a couple Sundays ago. It was really, really fun. I think it's one of the funniest and most fun experiences I've ever had in Star Citizen.
The naked guy, and
the piano cat. It was such a fun day, and to clip all those fun moments together into one video was really, really nice. And I was laughing while I was editing the video. So if you guys haven't checked that one out, definitely go ahead and check it out. It's the most recent video, and it's a really good time. It ties all three of us together in game playing together, which doesn't happen that often because of all of our time zones being completely different. So
will happen more often, though. It will.
Yes, it will. Hopefully, we get you guys in this Sunday or next Sunday. We'll see. But all right, guys, I think that's gonna be it for me and the Board Gamer. So everyone have a great one, and we'll see you all next week. All right. So be good, everybody. I hope you guys enjoyed it.
Bye, guys.
Bye, guys. Be good.
Catch us, Pokemon.
Yeah.